things that happened in the past, The Last Dance came on Sunday night. We did not have time for it yesterday. There were way too many topics going on. Last Dance has gotten, I mean, we've got 6 episodes of just destroying Jerry Krause. And the poor man is dead, and I kind of feel bad about it, but I also look at it as this is absolutely hysterical because this is who Michael Jordan is. When he hates somebody, he hates them until the end of time. It is the way that this man is wired, and it's you've heard all the stories, but when you see him actually discussing it, it is a whole different level. The way that he went after it, Michael said, after watching and seeing Jordan against Isaiah, Clyde, Ewing, Bird, and Magic, really makes me miss the old NBA. Absolutely hate these super teams. Yeah, I can understand that. The new NBA was based on basically the Dream Team. Everybody on the Dream Team got along. They were all playing along for the same reason. They never had to do that in the past. But yeah, the bashing of Jerry Krause, it gives you a deeper insight into exactly who Michael Jordan is. The
My
other
problem
side
with the bashing of Jerry Krause, and I think I'm on an island here because I tend to defend the guy more than most people. I don't care about. Here's the problem: they mock him for his physical feature. I mean, look, the guy can't help that he was born and he was as short as he is and whatever. And you know, yeah, he's an ugly dude. And it's easy to hate ugly dudes, and it's easy to make fun of ugly dudes. Yeah, it's low-hanging fruit. You're better than that. My issue is this guy was a hell of a GM. I mean, went out and he found Tony Kukoc. Man, Scottie Pippen might hate his ass, but I'm going to tell you, Scottie Pippen would not be the Scottie Pippen we know. I will die on this firm if Jerry Krause didn't go find him.
Oh, 100%.
Go get him.
Kukoc helped win the last 3.
Nobody else in the NBA was looking for him.
Yes. Agreed. But it again, that's another one of those deeper insights into exactly who Jordan is. He would find any kind of reason to get motivated to go whip your ass. Like, yeah. Tony Kukoc had never even spoken to Michael Jordan, had never done anything wrong to him. All he was doing was playing for his own national team.
But Jerry liked him.
But Jerry liked him.
And so I'm going to hate
him. And it flipped that switch. That's all it was. That's all it took.
And guess what? Jordan doesn't have those last 3 rings at the end of his career without Kukoc.
Without Tony Kukoc.
Major player on that team. 100%. And I'm really glad they did a good job of showing Kukoc in that second game in the finals where the Dream Team still won, but he didn't play like
back
some
down.
Kid. Yeah. He went up against those guys, and they made it personal the first game. He made it personal the second game. And you got to think Jordan respected that then.
Oh, yeah, 100%. 100%. I thought it was – look, this whole thing has been incredibly well done. I have been very impressed with just everything. And obviously it is – it's an infomercial. It was – you know, everything that's in here was allowed by Jordan and by, you know, Nike and all of that. I mean, the fact that they didn't have Sonny Vaccaro in it kind of irritated me. Obviously, I understand Nike doesn't like
him. Well, it's
just
wrong. It's just, it's not a documentary the way you look at normal documentary. Documentaries tell you the good, the bad, and the ugly. They tell you everything.
Everything.
And they cut, now, that's not true anymore. We very much have documentaries that are
politicized,
political, or one-sided. I mean, if you go on Netflix or Amazon right now, you can find a million documentaries that tell you meat is murder and others that say meat is the cure for every health disease you got. And those people can't be looking at the same sciences. They're telling you what they want you to hear and leaving out things that they don't want you to hear. So that, I guess that's not necessarily true. All documentaries, they didn't used to be. They didn't used to be so one-sided. But leaving Sonny Vaccaro out is a big deal. Sonny Vaccaro is the reason Nike is what they are today.
He is the one that came up with the idea of a signature shoe. He is the one that went.
He invented all of this. Converse didn't have a signature shoe. They had the NBA contract.
Yes. So they had everybody.
Everybody wore their shoes, not one person, and that doesn't help you.
Michael said, it was weird to see Kobe being interviewed. Pretty cool to hear him talk about his relationship with Jordan. Yeah. I mean,
I would tell you that was the best part of this, knowing that we're not going to get raw Kobe interviews ever again. That was cool.
That was about as raw as it gets. And with what he said, like, I don't get 5 titles. The Lakers don't get 5 titles without me learning from him. Right. And getting to see Jordan kind of take it to him in the All-Star game was a lot of fun. I mean, the kid was a year and a half into the league, you know. But at that point, a year and a half into the league, everybody in that Eastern Conference All-Star team in that locker room was talking about him a year and a half in.
Like they all knew Kobe's name, and none of them wanted to say it.
They were scared. They called him that little Laker boy, which was hilarious. Right. Everybody just seems to forget about him, and the conversation nowadays, because I guess we're prisoners of the moment, is always Michael Jordan against LeBron. Kobe.
It's weird because we did have a. We were robbed of this, by the way. We were robbed of ever getting a real Kobe LeBron final.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
If you want to point to the NBA absolutely not like throwing games and writing a script, that's evidence number one, and then it's case closed from there. If they wanted to try to manufacture something, they would have manufactured prime Kobe, prime Lakers against prime LeBron.
Did you get a chance to listen to the Yahoo College Sports podcast today?
Yeah.
From last night. All right, so one of the things that they brought up, and it kind of started the wheels turning because I went back and watched episode 6 last night, and they were discussing Jordan's gambling habits and et cetera. Was it a problem? Was it not? Like, when you've got that much money, I don't really think it's a problem if you're losing, you know, $1,057,000, whatever it is. If you're only losing that and you're pulling in, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars a year,
I don't know that he ever lost $1 million. Like, he had to write that guy a check for $57,000.
But that was the one. But then there was the other guy that said that it, like, wrote a book about how Jordan owed him $1.2 million in golf games or whatever.
That was a tab. If that really happened, that was not in a weekend.
No. It wasn't in a weekend.
That's a running tab.
And that's what I'm saying is that I don't think it was ever really a problem. But the story that they brought up on that podcast with Dan Wetzel and Pete Thamel and all them was the hockey player that, you know, went out, won a couple thousand dollars, whatever it was, from Jordan in a couple of golf games, and they played two 18-hole rounds in the same day, the day of their playoff game against the Cavs.
Yeah,
and drank all day, drank Coors Lights all day long, all played day. 36 holes, and then drove to the arena, and went and at the end of it, you know, the hockey player who whatever his name was told Jordan he was going to go take all the money that Jordan just gave him and go put it on the Cavs because you just played 36 holes and drank a bunch of beer, you ain't gonna be worth nothing tonight.
Yep.
And Jordan said, "We gonna beat him by 20." And I'm going to put up at least 35 or 40, whatever it was. And told him he was going to bet on himself. So he said, "You bet that against me, and then I'll take my money back." Now, if that story is the way that it is actually portrayed, which, and the hockey player prefaced it by saying, "I probably shouldn't be telling this story." If some of that stuff was found out in their investigations, could it be true, like this whole conspiracy about Jordan leaving basketball for a couple of years, could it be because they told him, "Hey, retire for a couple of years, go do the baseball thing, go do whatever"? Could it actually be what everybody has rumored for decades at this point, that he was actually banned from the NBA for gambling on the NBA?
It's really hard for me to think about that. Bill Simmons is the most connected person to the NBA that I've ever read, followed, whatever. So
that's why his following is so massive.
Yeah. When I go to the NBA and I'm looking for a take on something like this, I go to him because nobody's more connected or put more thought into it than him. There are two damning things. One real damning thing that hurts the Jordan's case on he wasn't really a suspended thing. He was asked, would he come back? And his response at some point in time was, if Stern will let me. Okay. So that's one blip on the whole radar that says maybe he really was. How do we explain that? Now, it could have just been Jordan, you know, dicking around, because he did that a lot.
Oh, yeah, he did.
I'll tell you, outside of it, trying to explain that one blip, I don't think there's any way on earth. Here's the thing. I think him and Stern have the relationship that that they had, which was unbelievable. Both of those guys kind of hated everybody they worked with all the time because they only cared about the results, getting the best results. I think they pushed people so hard that they were nobody was able to be close to them. I think there's some respect there because of that.
Yeah.
I think they saw themselves as very similar. One guy did it in business and the other guy did it on the court, but they're the same dude.
Oh yes.
Stern was just a little tiny Jewish guy and didn't have the physical abilities Michael had. But
he had the same mental game.
I think they treated people very much alike. The way Michael dicks with people and just openly just screws with them constantly and like cuts them down totally. The best Stern story I've ever heard in my life, Tony Kornheiser tells this story totally on his podcast once, that he was out in New York with a couple of other guys from the NBA and they were going to meet David Stern for dinner. It had been raining. Tony has this umbrella with him walking. He gets there. They're all standing around. Everybody meets Stern. Stern talks to him. They're all kind of standing there and it's a little quiet. Stern looks up at one of the guys that brought him and said, "Who brought Mary fucking Poppins?" and everybody just died. And Tony talks about how he just sunk. And he was just like, "This little guy just roasted me. And now the rest of the evening, he's up here and I'm down here."
Oh, yeah.
That is very much a Jordan. When you watch this, that's a Jordan line.
Oh, yes.
That is exactly what Jordan would do. So I don't think they would. I think there's a conversation that took place. I think Stern knew everything Jordan ever did. I don't think he ever lied to him about any of this. And I think those two had a respect and appreciation for one another to where they were like, "Okay, you need to make sure this stays so in-house, so buttoned up, and it's got to stop." And I think there was some Jordan didn't want to quit living the way he lived. And I think that's why he walked away. I really do. You see, they do a good job in this part of the show of getting to Jordan showing how the media just made that life unbearable.
Oh, it was,
we would all trade places with Jordan tomorrow. I know it was hard. I know it was stress. Every one of our broke asses would trade places with Jordan, but he was at a point where he was like, "Nobody in America would trade places with me." And while that's unrealistic for us, we absolutely would. But that pressure was that real. That stress was that real. And what we do to celebrities and famous people and sports people is disgusting. It really is.
Oh, yeah.
We talk about this all the time. How we write enough about them till we love them. We build them up. And then when we can't say any more good things about them, we immediately start trying to find out how we can destroy them. And then if they stick around long enough, we'll build you back up again.
Oh, yeah. I mean, remember for a long time, everybody hated Tom Brady.
Yep.
And then he stuck around long enough with New England that everybody loved him again.
He's with Tampa Bay and he could not be more likable to the rest of the nation.
Yes.
But you got to stick around long enough to ride those waves. And it's just the waves of I do get that, you know, there's some, people get fatigue. I understand that. I have a weird relationship with my feelings about LeBron James. Okay. But I don't think they go like this. I think there are some things that he does that I respect and appreciate and I value and I high him at a great pedestal. I think there are other things that he does that I think are petty, childish, and really disagree with.
Well, I mean, if you think about the Republicans buy Snickers 2 thing, you remember how much backlash, looking back on it, that Jordan got from just that one statement. He didn't want to make anything political. He was still building his brand. Like, people look at it. Let's see, Jim Johns said Tiger Woods is another one who had to learn how to ride that wave. Yeah, 100%. But with that whole...
He shouldn't have to ride the wave. I could address Tiger Woods' situation right now. Why the hell do you and I or anybody who's buying a Buick care if he cheated on his wife? The guy who makes the Buick commercials cheated on his wife, and so they got to quit hiring him to sell Buicks? This is the dumbest thing I've ever heard of in my life. Man, that is a personal situation between him and his wife. Did he beat her? No. Did he hurt his kids? No. I don't care. Anything else? I don't care. He didn't hurt anybody. He fucked a lot of people. Okay. Is that wrong?
Doesn't matter. Moral? Like, yeah, it might be.
So
Well, so I think the thing is, like, you
polygamy life, and they don't care.
Well, yeah, but here's the deal. They were built up, their reputation was built up in such a way that they were thought to be one thing. So, I mean, it is what it is. But the Jordan thing, part of me wonders because of, you know, Isaiah Thomas did get into the political field a little bit. He backed certain people, and Jordan never did. And I think that's why Jordan didn't. I think that's part of it. And I think that in turn, seeing how that affected Michael Jordan and how much backlash he got from, you know, his own community over that, it makes me think that's why LeBron James became such a political advocate. Like, that's what I'm guessing.
You paint yourself in a corner when you do that, and you can't do enough. You can't. I guess you can. You just got to be honest at all times about how you feel about every situation and not just draw a line and say, okay, I've chosen this team to cheer for, and so therefore everything they do I have to represent. That's the problem with doing what LeBron has done.
Yes.
Is he's chosen a side, and I don't care who you are, you don't agree 100% with one side. Nobody does. We're not wired that way, okay? Yeah. It's just not possible. It's not realistic, all right? So that's my bothersome. The person that I kind of equate this to today, that's a mega celebrity superstar, not close to Jordan, not close to LeBron James, but the people that love him, worship him, is Joe Rogan. And Rogan talks about politics and talks about the people that he likes and dislikes all the time, but that's an ever-changing thing as the waters change or the subject changes.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he was very open about having an appreciation for Bernie. But, and so everybody assumed, oh, well, he's super liberal. Well, then he came out and said, there's no one in the world I would vote for that I would vote for Biden over the other person. I don't care who the other person is, because I think Biden is now we're getting political, but this is Joe Rogan's words from his podcast. I think he is demented, and I think it's wrong what the political party's doing to push him, because I don't think he's capable of doing the job mentally, and that's just morally wrong. And so, therefore, I would vote for literally anyone else.
Yeah.
And it's one of those situations where if you're going to give your political opinions like LeBron does, be more like Rogan and just say, I'm picking this person. I'm picking this person. I'm not picking this party. I'm picking this individual.
Yes.
And these are the things I like about them.
Yeah. Better have a strong, you know, background, not background, but a strong, like, sense of what you are representing. That's the biggest thing is, and I think, like, you and I have discussed this all the time. Like, there is nothing wrong with changing your mind on a certain topic. I was a 4-team playoff guy forever. And then I thought more about it. I got more information. I really sat down and did my homework and whatnot. And I have changed. I'm not just an 18 playoff guy. Now I'm a 16 team playoff. Like, and that's just a minor thing.
If,
like,
you haven't changed your mind on many things in life in 10 years, if you can look back and 10 years ago, you believe the exact same that you believe right now, you are doing something wrong with your life. You have brought no new information in your world to where everything you had figured out to the letter and nothing new changed. I can't believe that. I just can't imagine we do that as people. I have changed so much, and I'm going to continue to change, because anytime new information comes into my brain, I have to process it.
Yes.
And it either makes my stance stronger.
Or it changes it.
Or it changes it.
Yes.
100%. And that's it. That's just it. But you have to process new information. I don't appreciate. Now, I have no idea what it's like to grow up black. And I don't know what it's like to grow up underprivileged in that situation. I got no clue. But I have an appreciation for the fact that LeBron, or that Jordan said, look, and he says he made the joke, Republicans buy sneakers too. But really, in his words, he said, I just didn't want to be a political activist because I'm not the kind of person people need to be getting their political advice from. Rogan says that all the time, by the way.
100%.
He gives his opinion and then says, I'm a guy that makes fart and dick jokes for a living. Please don't listen to me for your political advice.
100%. Make your own opinion.
Yes, make your own opinion. Get informed. And there's, I think there's more power in that if Jordan would have pushed that message more than just saying, I have no opinion. Say, I'm not going to give you my opinion. You need to figure this thing out for yourself And whichever side you fall on, push it, support it, believe in it, and be a part of it. But don't
listen to me.
Don't listen to me and do what I want to do politically, because my political views are completely different than yours.
Yeah, he still counts as one vote.
Yes, and I have a strong appreciation for the fact that he wasn't trying to sway things one way or the other.
But at the same time, he couldn't even vote in North Carolina anyway because he lived in Chicago. So,
you don't know that. We don't know that he doesn't have a dual residency, and which one can he vote in, which way not.
You
think he didn't have a house in North Carolina?
Nah, I mean, he probably owned his parents' house at that point.
I mean, so he probably could have voted in whatever district he wanted.
Let me catch up on these comments because they are flying in. Michael jumped in. I said, I'm sure the gambling stuff has not changed. I wouldn't be shocked if players bet other players on games against each other. McKinnon said, hated Brady for the first 8 years of his career, then respected him until I realized I was watching history before my eyes, and he's actually a good dude. He's a city slicker to a T, but he's still a genuinely good dude. I think a lot of people feel like that. Michael then said, I'm sure they gamble on anything and everything in the NBA. The whole cancel culture has ruined everything. Nobody wants to come out and be honest. That's 100% true. McKinnon said, Rogan is the freaking man on Facebook. On YouTube, Matt said, celebrities think we care about all their opinions.
Hang on, Matt.
Some do. Some don't.
We, as the collective universe, do. That's why they give their opinions, because millions of people believe them.
It's also why they get paid for marketing.
Do what they do.
Yeah. Let's see, Michael said, you can't speak your mind unless you're in the FU position. Ben said, who are you, Mike Leach? I don't know what that meant, but either way.
That's I would love to be more like Mike Leach.
You got that right.
I'll take his paycheck.
McKinnon said, if you aren't trying to learn to make yourself better every day, you're losing the race. And then Michael closed it out with, Jordan probably made a huge statement and the media plucked out the Republicans buying sneakers part to make it a bigger story. Now, he said the Republicans buying sneakers bit like as a joke to his other teammates.
And it was on the bus. Yeah, he didn't even say that to a reporter. Somebody told a reporter he said that. And he said he did.
Yeah, but he admitted it. But
he's like, it was just one of those things where he was dicking around.
Yeah, no, 100%.
There's no doubt gambling-wise, though, getting back to the gambling stuff, I assure you all of these guys bet on everything.
100%.
Everything. Every night of the week in the NBA, somebody is buying somebody else dinner because of something that happened in the game.
100%. I agree with you. Let's go ahead and move into our NFL discussion. Of course,